Wow, wait, what? I'm so confused that passed me. In 2016, I graduated from the University of Oxford with a degree in cell and systems biology. And getting into that uni was one of the proudest achievements of my life, I'd say. And until that moment that I actually had my A-level results in front of me that said I actually managed to get in, the thought of me being an Oxford student was kind of like a big joke in my mind. Like I didn't think it was ever actually gonna happen. And to be honest, that was kind of extended to the whole time I was there. Like I never really took the traditions very seriously. I definitely didn't take my first year exams very seriously, but I'll get onto that. I absolutely loved it. Some of the best years of my life thus far. But looking back, I'm even prouder of my little 18-year-old self and my little 21-year-old self for getting in and then graduating, because I really don't think I could manage either of those things now. All of the exam crammed knowledge that I used to have in my brain has pretty much exited it now. I did learn some things and I learned a lot about the way science is done, but the things I used to write essays about are pretty much gone. And almost as if to prove that point, here I have my final year exams from Oxford that I found in a box. So I thought it'd be fun to do something a little bit different, go through these, remind me of what I used to know, and to show you what some of the questions in an Oxford final exam are like, if you even care. So let's take a look at these bad boys. Seeing as this is a bit of a different chatty video, I've also added chapters so you can skip to whatever you fancy. This is definitely a dabbler as far as my videos go. So these are the four exams that I took in the summer of 2016, which was my final year at uni. And there's three terms at Oxford and they're called Michaelmas, Hilary and Trinity. So these were taken in Trinity term. As you can see there, it's legit. The first time I saw these, it's bringing back all happy memories, I was wearing this like exam costume called Subfusc. Here's some photo proof. I have a red carnation on here because that's like a tradition. You see, you wear a white carnation for your first exam, a pink carnation for your exams in between, and a red carnation for your final exam. The black and white outfit is a requirement for taking an exam, strangely enough, but the carnation is not. Now, while my course was called Biomedical Sciences, you came out of that with a degree either called Cell and Systems Biology or Neuroscience. And obviously, I wanted a degree in Neuroscience, but I didn't do enough psychology options to get that, so I got Cell and Systems Biology. Absolutely gutted. In your final year, you choose a topic that you major in that you answer three questions on in your final exam, and a topic that you minor in that you answer two questions on. So my major was molecular medicine, which is basically genetics, and my minor was neuroscience. So that explains what these two exams are. These are my molecular medicine and my neuroscience exams, but there's also two more. There's one with synoptic questions where you need to answer by pulling in knowledge from as many different modules as possible, including ones that you haven't even technically studied. And in that one, you basically get points for like outside of the box thinking. And also you have like a scientific paper analysis one where you're given a scientific paper and you have to write your own abstract for it without seeing the original one and answer questions on it and like criticize it and stuff. Something I actually used to do that I need to dig out the old videos for. I used to revise in my room with my webcam on and film myself revising and film myself like explaining stuff to myself.
Hey, it's coming, sleepy, and I need my dinner. I haven't actually had a meal today, maybe that's why, and after dinner I'll be like, boom, sick. Oh, this goes in important now. Okay, Creevel 2010.
I did also take exams in my second year, which I also have here, but I'm not going to go through those. And I took exams in my first year that, as I said, I didn't do very well in, because basically, in first year at uni, everyone's like, oh yeah, you just have to pass, which is true. So everyone convinces you that they're not revising at all. So I was like, oh yeah, like, I just need to pass, that's chill. So I kind of had a really fun summer term and didn't do very well at all, actually. I still passed. I think I came second bottom in the year, I think, which, you know, second bottom of the year at Oxford, still pretty decent. The biomedical sciences course is quite small though. There was only like 30 of us, so. Okay, so first of all, I actually can't remember what's in these at all. I'm quite intrigued. So first we have my molecular medicine exam paper, which I had to answer three questions in. It's three essays in 3 hours, and each essay is basically meant to be like a mini scientific review of that topic. Oh yeah, so one other thing I need to mention. for this exam to make sense. So in each subject, you're given themes. For example, molecular medicine is split into 8 themes. Now, I can't even remember the themes I chose, so let's see. So we've got principles of gene regulation, which is basically the basics, the molecular genetics of disease, which is like, you could just take out the word molecular and it would kind of mean the same thing. Fertilization and early human development, which I hated, but not as much as I hated embryonic patterning. Honestly, it's just like pictures of fly bodies, but like baby fly egg bodies that are stripy. It's not the vibe. Brain development at the molecular and cellular level sounds interesting, but again, hard. Chromosome biology, which I quite liked. Genes development and cancer, always interesting. Bloody love genes and cancer, very interesting. Not, I didn't love cancer, obviously. I liked the topic a lot. And it's good because I've got a video on cancer coming up soon. Molecular and cellular therapeutics, that's basically how to use small things to make yourself feel better. And that's it. So let's look at the ones I actually answered. Oh, look at that. Question number 4. Straight in with Huntington's disease. Compare and contrast the molecular pathology of Huntington's disease and Fragile X syndrome. So I feel like I would have seen this question and be like, tasty question. As you can see here, I've written about the CAG repeat, which is what I talked about in the video, and poly-Q, Q is glutamine. Huntington's and Fragile X are both due to 3 bases being repeated again and again and again and again and again. And as I've said before, Huntington's leads to an excessive amount of protein being made and the problems come that way. Whereas with Fragile X, the repeat leads to a gene being switched off, which means something isn't produced. And so you can see how nice this question is, I'm sure, because you're basically comparing 2 things that have a similar basic pathology, which is like disease causing nature, but there's a lot of differences there. Ah, now molecular and cellular therapeutics, let's take a look at this. So question 22 is, discuss the advantages of using non-viral vectors compared with viral vectors in gene therapy. This one interested me a little bit. A vector is just something that carries something, so the question is, if you want to put something in your body, is it better to do it via a virus that you've made work for you, or is it better to do it in a different way? There's obvious things that are wrong with either, like a virus is more likely to get exactly where you want, but also your body is more likely to react to it, yada da da da. But despite the interesting things about this topic, I did not pick it. I picked question 23. What are the key similarities and differences between therapeutic gene editing and RNA interference? Oh, I can see why I picked this one. And I'm right in there with the citations. Judge 06 with ApoB, RAN 15. Genuinely, I feel like the hardest bit of these exams is remembering all the bloody names of everyone who's done other studies. I used to revise by, I had loads of post-its that had the name of a study on the front, and on the back it said what the general findings of the studies were, and I would like read the name and then say what I thought and then read the back, and if I got it right and went in one pile, and if I got it wrong and went in the other, and then I would go to my room and find a blank wall and I would like come up with an essay question or find an essay question, and then I'd like stick these post-its and like draw like arrows between them and say how they're all linking. Man, I used to be smart. I really did. Hello, Edit Sophie here. I dug out my old marks and I have them here, but just before I show them to you, I know there's a lot of Americans watching, as in proportionally, not that a lot of America is watching. British university exam marks are probably quite different to yours. All you need to know is that 70 and above is like really good top grade. 60 to 70 is what's known as a second class division 1 or 2-1, and that's like pretty good. Then 50 to 60 is 2-2, which is less good. And 40 to 50 is a pass. Anything below 40 and you've failed. So whilst a mark of 70 might not look like very much to you, it is actually quite the achievement here. So in my molecular medicine paper, I got 64, which is a middle 2-1. That's all right. And if you're wondering how I did in my first year papers that gave me prize position of second bottom in the year, then I got a 56 in one, a 52 in another, and a 47 in the third. Oh, I should have done them in order, shouldn't I? I should have done them in order that I actually did the exams. Too late for that. So this is paper 3, which is actually the one you do first. I guess they ease you in by being like, here, just analyse this paper. There you go. And then you'll have to have your knowledge for your next ones. So there is a paper for each option, and you can pick, but obviously you're going to pick either your major or minor option. So as you can tell from looking at these sheets, the neuroscience one did not appeal to me whatsoever, but the molecular medicine one obviously did. They're all legit papers that existed. So yeah, let me find this paper. I'm gonna do it now. Oh my God, here it is. Clostridium novienti can cause regression of all the topically implanted glioblastomas in rats.
Catchy.
I can just picture myself absolutely cacking myself when I saw that. Wait, what was my other option? What was my neuroscience one? Why didn't I go for that one? Basal forebrain circuit for sleep wake control. What? Why didn't I pick this one? I loved sleep science. Wow, wait, what? I'm so confused that passed me. I think maybe I just went in like, no matter how nice the neuro paper is, I know molecular medicine way better. So I'm just gonna pick that, whatever, however the chips may fall. What did I get in this paper? Was it a wise decision? I got a 67, which is a mid to high 2-1. So I did that paper on the Tuesday, and then this paper on the Wednesday, which was the neuroscience paper. We have a whopping 10 themes to pick from here, ladies and gentlemen. Ion channels, hate that. Synaptic transmission, potentially interesting, but a bit much. Sensory processing, which covers two whole themes. It's such a big old deal. Synaptic plasticity, sounds very cool. A lot of spiky graphs. Circadian neuroscience, the one that I truly loved, which is all like sleep science, wiring up the brain, you know, like it's an electrician course. Degeneration, regeneration, and repair. You may have already guessed that was my jam. Then there was biology of brain disorders, which I feel like I will have dipped my toe in occasionally. And then sensory motor integration, which, you know, is at the end because it's quite forgettable. I would just like to emphasize as well that while I'm talking about all this, oh, I didn't know that, and oh, you know, really have to slim how much you study. I studied so hard. Like, you just have to just cut loose like 7/8, 6/8, 3/4 of the topics, because there's no way you could study them in enough detail to write an essay on them that does well. So let's have a little look at circadian neuroscience. Oh, this is actually quite interesting because it's talking about photoreceptors that lead to images being produced and your photoreceptors that don't, because often in school we're taught we've got two types of eye receptor rods and cones, but you actually have a third, retinal ganglion cells, I think they're called, that's digging out of the back of my brain, and those are the ones that react to light in terms of your sleep rhythms. So they found that because if you get a mouse and you stop its rods and cones from working, it still has a regular sleep pattern, but if you take out its eyes, sorry, that's horrible, but still, it doesn't have a regular sleep pattern. So scientists were like, well, there we go, it seems like we have a third receptor that doesn't have any kind of image role with light. It is all about controlling how you sleep. And so yeah, you have rods, cones, and a third type of eye receptor. Just another way that high school biology lies to you. What I went for was 18, why is sleep disruption relatively common in neuropsychiatric and or neurodegenerative disorders? And I circled neuropsychiatric and neurodegenerative just in case I missed them on the second read. And I underlined why, because that was probably what I was asking myself as I was sitting in that exam in a boiling room in a costume. Then we skip to degeneration, regeneration, and repair, where we have discussed the molecular mechanisms underlying the formation of protein aggregates found in neurodegenerative diseases. Illustrate your answer with specific examples. Oh my gosh. When I saw protein aggregates, I must have flipped my absolute lid. Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, Huntington's. I've got them written there. PD, HD, AD. That, oh, hold me back, I'm coming for you. And in my neuroscience paper, I got a 66, which is, guess what, a middle 2-1. Okay, that's 3 out of 4 done. You're 3/4 on your way to getting a final year portion of the degree. So let's do our last paper. The one I was most scared of because it's such a, like, an unknown, but also there's something about it that's kind of freeing. So it's the synoptic paper. The neuroscience one was on the Thursday, the molecular medicine one was on the Friday, and then this was on the Saturday. Yes, exams on a Saturday. Woot woot, 28th of May, 2016. What a day. That was the day I was probably the smartest in my life. life, Saturday the 28th of May. So this is a 3-hour exam in which you answer 2 questions. So lucky you, you get an hour and a half per essay rather than an hour. And yeah, it's the one where you have to bring together ideas from as many different themes as possible. I just remember before this last exam, I had had like a couple of energy drinks and I like put a Hawaiian lei on my neck to try and make myself feel like I was having a fun time. Yeah, I don't think it necessarily worked. I remember being really itchy.
Yeah, so, oh, it's actually really itchy. I don't want to wear that.
Memories. Anyway, let's have a look at this paper. Ooh, more scribbles. Yeah, so again, you can answer any 2 questions from any themes. So obviously I was going to stick to what I knew. Oh my God, I drew a little love heart next to a question, which means I was both excited and pathetic. Let's see what garnered the love heart. How might cancer-specific therapy, of course it was cancer, how might cancer-specific therapies be developed by exploiting molecular and genetic differences between cancer cells and normal cells? Wow, okay, that isn't lighting the same spark in my brain now as it must have done at the time to get a love heart, like it's a childhood crush of a question. So obviously in this question I went down the immune systems route a bit, because I'm talking about CAR T cells. CAR T cells are basically immune system cells that get like engineered to attack cancer cells. What else we've got? Okay, so I was torn between doing developmental biology relevant to the goals of regenerative medicine, which means I will have gone for discuss the underlying mechanisms by which changes in chromatin structure may be associated with specific human genetic diseases. Aha. Chromatin, another very interesting thing. Basically, the way that DNA is stored also has an impact on the way it is kind of expressed in your body. So we have loads of genes in our body that are inactive, and the DNA that has those genes on could be wrapped more tightly around these things called histones, and the whole structure is called chromatin. But the more tightly the DNA is wrapped, the harder it is for kind of transcription stuff to access it, so the harder it is for the DNA to get built, which means that the tighter the DNA is wrapped, the less likely your gene will be expressed, basically. And on the flip side, genes that are expressed really often need to be easy access, as it were, so they're wrapped really loosely. And final grade in my Synoptic questions paper, I got a 71. She made it over 70. What a joy. And that is it. Those are my 4 finals papers. Finishing those signaled the end of my degree and me being free to forget it all. So yeah, if you want to see any of my other old exams or hear my thoughts or whatever, Tell me what you're interested in. Okay. Like this video if you like it, share it if you share it, subscribe it if you subscribe it, and comment if you have any thoughts. And if you have any answers to any of those questions, then go for it. Tell me what you want to see next. And otherwise, all that's left to say is thank you so much for watching, have a lovely day, and remember to make like an exam paper and keep asking questions. And a huge thank you to my Patreons, without whom none of this would be possible. I appreciate your support so much, each and every one of you. If you also want to be a patron, then do check out the link in my description or on the end card. A special shout out, as always, goes to Adam Dullinger, Terry Cox, and Justin Brown. Now you're just some knowledge that I used to know, some knowledge that I used to know, some knowledge. Now you're just some knowledge that I used to know. I went on to be a disappointment. That's a joke, I'm proud of myself. I don't even know who Huckleberry Finn is. Ooh. But yeah, wow, I just thought this might be a really, really boring video. Anyway. I feel like I probably answered this question below averagely, but silly little 2016-year-old me, 2016, 21-year-old me, little slice of heaven. It was worth it for the fun I had. And you made it to the end. Here's a link to the Patreon, which has more stuff like scripts videos, access to doodles, access to extended outtakes, yada, yada, yada. And here's a playlist of my faves and an extra video for you. Bye.